Go.
Yeah.
All right, let me get the full thing. There it is.
Beautiful. Oh. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Bobcast Podcast, Episode 8. Tuning to you not live, because I couldn't get the streaming thing in order up in time, but you're watching on the YouTube channel archive. Welcome, everybody. Hope you've been doing very well. We've actually had an exciting week for most of us, at least for Mark and I. We had some pretty fun... I don't know what you... Well, in terms of...
Shots.
Okay, let me...
Shots fired.
All right. Talkable...
Thanks.
Topics that we can discuss for our loyal listeners that are interested
right.
in this sort
of most thing. Of the things I do on the daily are classified, so thank you for being conscious.
I'm just trying to protect you, man. I'm trying to be a friend, and you're calling me out.
I do appreciate it.
Anyway, we got lots of topics to talk about today. A lot of focus. I think the big story is definitely DX12. The first reviewer DX12 version is out there, basically DX12 benchmark directly comparing DX11 to DX12. Very interesting results that came from that. We'll take a look at those from all the different review sites, showing you how everyone reviewed it differently. There's a lot of different methods that people use, and they're all pretty much are showing a very similar result. Another news as well, some new technology coming out of the Intel conference that happened in San Francisco over the last several days. Basically, we're learning more about Skylake, how it functions, why it's a good processor and a good enthusiast processor. Also touching on some new... Basically, the future of storage. We had solid-state drives definitely becoming more and more saturated in the commercial world as it is now, but we're moving on to greater and better things as basically those storage drives are becoming more and more of a bottleneck for our systems. All that and more on the 8th Bobcast Podcast.
Yeah, we can hear people over this intro, right?
Yeah.
Just the worst production value.
I'm making it interesting, man. Jesus! Anyway.
Are you?
So, how you guys doing? You guys doing well? For joining here with Tom and Mark, the regulars on the show. We have Connor, Ryan, and Kevin. Kevin never heard from again, so that's unfortunate. Connor, I guess, has a legitimate excuse. He just moved and still doesn't have internet, so... That's, I guess, a legitimate excuse.
I don't accept that.
Ryan, I have no idea what the hell he's doing, so we'll just assume he's...
Nothing worthwhile.
That's what I said.
I wonder if he's drinking.
No. Who drinks on a Wednesday?
Ryan never drinks.
That never happens.
I was going to say, wait, do you know?
I don't know what made me think about this. We have in my Walmart store. I'm in a predominantly college town, and there's like a big welcome back students poster. And it's on the front of a beer pong table with a cup set up. And it's like, well, they know their demographic.
Yeah, dude.
I'm waiting to see just some parent walk in, see this, and be like, start complaining. I know that's going to happen at some point, but whatever. We were in the town or in the news national. I don't think it's quite national. It's definitely regional. A few years ago, there was a fraternity that had a big sign up on their front of their house that said, you know, freshman girl drop off. And it's like, oh, Jesus Christ. So really, really
so,
rocking
so clever.
Solid.
Keeping it classy.
We're definitely doing really well recruiting students.
Oh, yeah.
The Western advantage. So, Mark, you've stepped into the 900 series. You're the second person in the Band of Bros to do so. So you've moved on to the 970. You've had it, what, for 24 hours, about?
Yes, I got it yesterday, but I haven't really done anything with it.
Okay.
Until today.
Nice. So you mentioned you were playing Far Cry 4 earlier. How's that been treating you then?
Well, I couldn't actually see how many frames I was getting because if you have MSI Afterburner open... It crashes right away, because that's how good Ubisoft makes games. But it ran great, as far as I could tell, and it was on all ultra. Looked really nice, so...
Nice.
It's a good
that's
sign.
That's really good to hear. Nice. So, old 660s, I guess we'll touch on that. Your old 660 Ti, are you still trying to sell the one on Amazon, or have you been able to...
I actually believe I did. I haven't gotten an email yet, but it says that it's pending, and it's not in stock anymore. So I'm assuming that means... Somebody bought it.
Okay. Gotcha. So the economy that we keep discussing is coming in full force again. The other 660 Ti of yours is now in my possession. Basically, shameless plug for this channel. On Friday, We're going to be doing a live Q&A and live construction build guide on how to build a computer and all that kind of stuff this Friday. It'll also be uploaded to YouTube after the fact. So if you're interested in building a computer, come join us on the Twitch chat, and I'll try and help you answer all your questions that I commonly will get on all my different YouTube channels and things. So 660 Ti will be the graphics powerhouse for this computer. AMD Phenom 2 hex core processor and some crappy motherboard I got from Micro Center for $43. So,
hey, that thing's a workhorse.
Looking forward to it.
I've never had a problem with my Linux computer down there.
I mean, nothing. I've had it cooled with a cup of water before and I had it like a champion. So, I mean, it's basically been my messing around computer for the longest time. I think I'm actually going to give it a purpose in the world of computers. So, it's going to be pretty fun.
Got to make a server.
And I'm rocking the sweet AmpX RAM.
Ooh.
I don't know what this is exactly.
Wait, is that like in a G-Skill case?
This is, yeah, the RAM that I got from you.
Okay.
I put that in here and took there. This RAM out of my computer.
I was going to say, I didn't know G-Skill had an AmpX line.
I have no idea what this is. It's DDR3 1600.
I think that's the brand that I have in that like really stupid Pentium machine back there. The 1066 RAM I bought.
How did you end up with 1066 RAM in the first place?
Was it's a Mushkin, building? I think.
Is that when you were first building that computer?
Yeah, for people who haven't heard this story, when I first built my computer all those years ago, I think at this point it's coming up on 5 or 6.
Yeah, 2000. I think it was, what, January 2011?
11. I think it was 11, yeah. I guess 4. But yeah, no, it's... I mean, I guess it just comes down to uneducated buying, really. I was like, I just need RAM, right? Like, I don't know what's a good speed. I was going for capacity more so.
Mm-hmm.
So I just, I think it was just a Newegg, you know, on sale, 8 gigs. It was just a moderately priced couple of sticks. And I was like, yeah, all right, this will work.
Hey, at least so it's still serving a purpose and something, I guess. So.
It is still serving a purpose. Wait, but didn't I? Oh, yeah, no, I still have that. That's it. No, where is that?
Or do you not have that RAM?
I don't know where that RAM is, to be honest. It might
not
be.
Not important.
Hang on. It might be in this. Let's find out.
Is that your Linux machine, or is that your just secondary?
This is my Linux machine. This is also the original box that I built my computer in, which you wouldn't think you could fit a 560 Ti in, but you can after a few, just pushing around a little.
Did you ever have the 680 in there, or did you move on to a different?
No, I had moved on to the Antec 300 at that point.
Is it also the case that like, oh, that's got the little suction thing on the side fan that's like aimed right at the CPU?
Oh,
right?
Yeah. So this has a little. I have a secondary fan here that pulls in, and you can't really see it, but basically it's the stock cooler, so it's pushing directly out, so it just pushes right out the side.
Is that pulling, right? Or is that push again?
It's pulling.
Pulling, okay. So pulling the hot air. Okay.
Yeah. I don't actually... All I know is that these aren't the RAM sticks that I started with. So I don't know where those are.
Okay. Whatever.
I don't know. They honestly might just be in my computer parts bin.
Okay. Always good to waiting. Have those.
You what?
I said always good to have this extra parts laying
always
around.
Always good to have. I think, honestly, yeah, I'm going to probably make this into a server. I busted it.
That's the Pentium one you said?
No, this one is the hex core. It's the same.
Oh, okay. So you actually use that computer then, like, kind of, sort of?
Kind of. I haven't set it up since I got home, so, I mean, I haven't used it in the last 3 months.
Okay.
But I used it a lot more in school whenever I needed to be doing various Linux things.
Nice.
So, but yeah, now I think I'm just going to make a server out of it just so I can access my files from wherever in my house.
I think that's something I was planning on doing here. I'm starting to set up just kind of like a really basic server I think I wanted to do with it, and I'm going to turn it into some type of like weather server. I think I'm going to try and launch different weather applications on there and try and use all that CUDA on the 660 Ti, so I'm pretty excited for that.
You realize you have to learn how to program if you're going to use CUDA,
I'll just use the internet, and I'll just get basic knowledge for what I have to do, and then done. That works out really well for me. So
yeah.
Mark, why don't you have a second computer yet, man?
Meanwhile, Mark over here
I don't need
pleb one computer
What do I need a shitty second computer for?
Whoa, wait a minute.
Dude, this computer's honestly better than some people's actual computers.
Not better than your main one that you use.
Well, no, but I don't... Wait, you think I need two main computers?
No, you need one, and that's it.
I mean...
I don't know, man.
I mean, I kind of understand, like, Nick, what are you... You're using yours for weather shit or something?
Primarily, yeah. We're going to be setting up a second office and having stuff
and
in there,
even so. Tom, I don't know what you use your second one for.
Well, like, all the illegal things we're talking about earlier. The things we can't talk about.
So. Oh, okay, well...
Oh, I was going to say, wait, like... did you just out us on a podcast?
I wouldn't do such a thing. What are you talking about?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Right? I don't, you know, call the NSA and CIA and FBI and secretly report people to get those dollars, you know, all those reward money.
Do you get money for turning people in?
If it leads to an arrest, usually.
Dude, I should have been sending people up way long ago. Alright, anyway. Moral of the story, I don't really use this for a lot of things.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm still trying to figure out how to make the cluster function. I started looking at really basic ways of getting a cluster to work.
Nick,
but
look up Rocks. It's super simple. It's just a Linux OS.
Well, see, that's my problem.
No, dude, it's really simple. You install it right in the configuration. It's just like assign this a node number. You assign, is this the head node? You say yes. You just put them all on the same network. It just fucking works.
I mean, like, obviously it's that like, wouldn't work with Windows machines, so, right? They wouldn't do that.
Well, it's an operating system, so no.
Okay. Well, the problem is I want to get my Windows computer to render videos faster by using different computers.
Here's what you do, Nick. Here's what you do. Okay. You set up... All right, first of all, no one ever has made a supercomputer that runs Windows. It's a shit system.
So it's gonna happen. I'm gonna be the first.
Runs Linux. So you run Linux, okay. But what you do is you get an open source video editor that that supports render farms. They exist. The problem is they only exist right now on Linux. So
I think the problem too that you're saying is open source. I think those are the keywords for terrible video editor.
Dude,
how long have you spent trying to find a video editor that's open source that works?
They work.
So where's that YouTube content, bro?
They work. They just only work on Linux. That's why I have a second Linux box, so that I can render videos. All right. Not to go down this road, but I just found one. I haven't tried it out because I haven't gamed much in the past week. When I do, I will start populating the channel, and we're going to come roaring back. All right? This is just the start.
You heard it here first, guys.
Heard it here first. It's happening. My triumphant return. I also have I'm sitting on a ton of footage from, like, a year ago. I got some Battlefield Hardline beta footage, okay, that I could throw out there. I've got some
relevant now.
That we played, like, once. So, I could put that all up there. It's all quality content.
Well, be looking forward to that then.
So, everyone, yeah, look forward to that. I'm definitely not going to have a set release schedule.
I mean, who needs schedules? Those never work and fall through anyway, so. All right, well, jumping into the first topic, it's actually really, really relevant for Mark, considering he just got the 970. Basically, the first DX12... benchmarks are out and about, which is pretty freaking cool. And it's basically I just went to the next video. Oops. So basically, the benchmarks for this have actually been really, really surprising for a number of reasons. The system that these people are using, it was a R9 390, and they ran two different. This is from Digital Foundry. Ran two different tests, one with an i3, one with an i7. Ran both systems using DX12 and then DX11. And I think the most surprising thing that came out of this initial benchmark, this is the first basically reviewer sample DX12 benchmark available, is that the i3 and the R9 390 running in DX12 is like almost double performing the i7 4790K with the R9 390. Like, if this is a baseline for DX12, at least a rough idea for DX12, really, really interesting that they can squeeze all this performance out from these AMD cards. And I mean, this has definitely got me a little bit more excited for DX12. I was always on the fence about how excited I should be. I mean, I can't imagine APIs is something going to make, you know, my computer run games at 4K, 60 FPS, no problem. But even like those, the subtle and small gains in performance could be really, really interesting. And this example is quite interesting. So, what's your take, Tom, on this?
My take. All right. So here's the problem.
Okay.
Let me bring you down a peg here. In terms of excitement, as a person, I take shots at you all the time. I'll take a break at that for a second.
Remember when we first met, by the way?
And just ruin your day.
Punched me in the arm. Yeah, I remember that.
All right, story time, kiddies. Here's what happens. There's this kid that everyone hated in high school. Not like, you know, because he's an asshole or, you know, for any particular reason. He just had like a really punchable face. And and he was just annoying. He's just one of those piece of shit kids. Everyone knows him. So one day, we're walking down the hallway.
He deserved it too, by the way. He wasn't just like a person I would have made fun of. Like, he was an asshole and deserved it.
He's an ass, yeah. All right. So anyway, we're walking down the hallway. I'm leaving school. Nick's walking in. But he's like, for some reason, he's like flying in the shadow of this guy. I guess just staying on his six so that I don't see him. Like World War II pilot or some shit. So anyway, this kid goes in for a high five. And I'm like, no, fuck this guy. I'm going to punch it. I'm going to punch it instead. I go for the punch. Kid drops his arm, keeps walking. Nick's behind him. I'm like, shit, but it was too late to pull back, so I just socked him right in the arm. And we were forever friends from that moment on.
Oh my God.
There you go.
It's a real touching moment that I, you know.
Starting with a bang. Anyway.
So DX12.
DirectX12.
Destroy it for me, please.
So DirectX12. No, here's the thing. It is great. Like you said, an API, you find it hard to believe that it can do all this stuff. The whole point of the API is that programmers can really get right down onto the hardware level and unlock its full potential. The reason I'm not super pumped about this is look at your standard program. Most programs today don't utilize all of the cores on your computer. You know, you have four cores standard, right? And it's nice because you can open up 10 different programs and they can all each, you know, this core takes two, this core takes two, whatever. And you can run pretty quick. But one program can also use all of the cores on your computer. Now, Nick, you probably have some experience with this when you're rendering videos.
Yep.
If it's multi-cored, it goes faster. Most programs don't take advantage of that. The problem is the programmers have to specifically code it to take advantage of the hardware. Same with DX12. It tries to make it a lot easier, but the programmers have to go in and they have to actually put forth the effort to utilize all that DX12 has to offer. Now, the idea is that they have to put less effort in. That's the point of DX12, is that it opens up the hardware to a very high level so that almost anyone can do it, but it still means they really have to go on. And the fact is that most games that come out today, even now, are still using DX9, and a lot of them haven't even moved up to 11. So... Mm-hmm. Yes, there's a lot of potential there, but I'm not on the edge of my seat. Like, any day now, everything's going to be, you know, it's all going to look amazing and I'll be able to get. And also, we haven't really pushed the limits. I mean, I can only think of maybe a few games that really are pushing cards. You know, I mean, back in the day, like when I first got my computer, one of the first games I bought was Crysis, just to see if it could run Crysis, right? And that was a game where, like, if you had a good machine, it was a way to just really torture test it. Well, the only games I can think of doing that now are like The Witcher 3. Mm-hmm. I mean, games that are made to like only really run well, even at like 1080 Ultra on current hardware in like 3 years.
Yeah.
Or maybe GTA 5. I mean, that's another... Although you said you get pretty good.
It's really well optimized. I mean, it's not that it's, you know, not even like a... They cut in errors, but I mean the game itself seems to run really, really well, and it basically it's optimized for systems really, really well.
But can you max it, like everything maxed?
For the most part, 60? Yes. I got 2670. I mean, I'm SLing 670s too,
yeah.
So I'm not necessarily kind of like an average or even
that's
like
true. That's
near average. So
yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I'm still excited for it. I still think it's neat, but.
definitely a quick little glimpse anyway into what could be a beautiful, beautiful thing. So, but I think the most interesting, I think this is what a really good question for Mark coming here in a second, is the next article that comes from Ars Technica. Basically, basically DirectX 12 is proving to be kind of an early win for AMD, as seen in that last video that was using an AMD card, and a rather disappointment for NVIDIA. And I think it all comes down to the fact that NVIDIA is really, really well optimized for DX11. And that's why NVIDIA has really been blowing away AMD kind of this recent generations, because their products have been running really, really well for DX11. Meanwhile, AMD has been focusing on other things like Mantle, not so much, I guess, focusing all their attention in one place, putting all their eggs in one basket, as it were. And so the interesting things were that in this benchmark, again, using the same benchmarking program, Ashes of the Singularity, basically showed that a R9 290X was toe-to-toe with a brand new GTX 980 Ti in performance using this DX12 benchmark, which, again, it's a single benchmark that's brand new, so don't consider this to be the end-all be-all, but it's still interesting to look at. And the benchmarks were quite interesting, I'm not gonna lie. It's older hardware and cheaper hardware, albeit hotter hardware, is running better, if not the same, as top of the line and flagship material from NVIDIA. So Mark, you just purchased the 970, so you purchased the new generation for NVIDIA products. I mean, hearing about these benchmarks coming out, are you a little worried that maybe you should have joined the red team as opposed to staying with the green team?
Well, I mean, if they could optimize for DirectX 11 so well, why can't they do it with DirectX 12?
I guess that's part of the thing, too, is that it almost seems like AMD was kind of future-proofing with some of their cards. Well, NVIDIA was focused really just on the present time, which isn't bad, per se.
Yeah.
And, of course, NVIDIA, they're kind of calling hacks on this benchmark. To quote them directly, we believe there will be better examples of true DX12 performance, and we continue to work with Microsoft on their DX12 API, games, and benchmarks. The GeForce architecture and drivers for DX12 performance are second to none. When accurate DX12 metrics arrive, the story will be the same as it was for DX11. So they're basically saying all of this is lies and slander, and they're not believing any of this, and they're basically calling this Ashes of the Singularity benchmark garbage, as you would expect if your products don't look good compared to the competition. You got to defend yourself somehow. I don't think that was the best way in doing it. I think they could have said something along the lines of, like, we're going to improve our drivers, blah, 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 blah. And keep in mind, too, I mean, this is like the first thing running DX12, so neither the red team nor the green team has had a chance to really make driver-specific things for games and things, so I don't know. And again, Mark, this is particularly interesting to you because the Eurogamer benchmark that they used, different than the other two, but still using Ashes of Singularity, they actually used the 970, so that's like, obviously what he just bought. And they're comparing it to the R9 390. And it was kind of a similar situation with the R9 390 blowing away the NVIDIA product here. And especially, not blowing away, but DX12 blowing away DX11 for the NVIDIA product. While when looking at the NVIDIA cards, they were not quite as much of an improvement. In fact, in both Eurogamer and in Ars Technica's benchmarks, they found that the DX12 frame rates were actually less in DX12 than they were in DX11. So, there it is. Our first taste of DX12, and there's already all sorts of controversy. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. So, I don't know.
It's just a matter of optimization.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, This is the first game to truly utilize it. You just got to give it time.
Yeah, we shall see. I mean, NVIDIA definitely has the software backing. I mean, their drivers are always so much better than AMD's, typically much more stable. And so they definitely have the like the software department to really engineer drivers better. So I wouldn't be surprised if we see this improve through time. So that's kind of
sorry,
an area.
Something just hit me.
And that's kind of an area where AMD has been kind of lacking in the driver department.
I got the one guy in the closet making drivers for everybody.
Pretty much.
He's probably right next.
You just email him directly, like, "Hey, can you fix it?
Custom build."
And he'll just make you a driver.
He's probably right next to the guy that just yells at the CPU creators to add more cores to their CPUs. So.
You know, all right, speaking of drivers, I got a Windows update today that was like NVIDIA drivers. And I'm like, nah, Windows update. I get those from NVIDIA. Thanks, though. I don't know what this is.
I got that as well. It was, and I believe it was an old driver. I had a newer version already.
I Googled it, and everyone online was like, "Yeah, this basically just breaks your computer and it's outdated." And I'm like, "Okay, so don't do it." Good.
Is this Windows 7 or Windows 10?
This is 7.
That was back when I had 7. That doesn't happen on 10.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of weird.
In 10, it just installs it anyway for you, and then you just deal with it.
Oh, you know, I wish.
And you get locked in a reboot cycle.
I'm adding.
You heard about that, right?
I'm adding the store to the dock. But yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, basically, there were people who, like, because they just automatically update for you, they got an update, and then they just got locked into a reboot cycle. We would just reboot, say it was updating, and then reboot again, and just wouldn't stop doing that. So, Microsoft, people. Millions of dollars behind a system, and that's what you get.
God, love it.
But speaking of...
I'm trying to find... Basically, there's a company suing Microsoft for the constant updates, because one of the big things with Windows 10 was pushing is kind of getting rid of this Patch Tuesday kind of thing, is having constant updates, constantly running updates. And there are a lot of people that are complaining because this is eating people's data caps. It's not necessarily in the US, but definitely in other countries where they have data caps.
Yeah,
it's eating away at this, and they're starting to be like, you know, whoa. Like you're causing us some big problems here, and so they're trying to sue Microsoft for these constant updates. Am I the only one that thinks these lawsuits should be directed at the service providers for data capping?
This isn't in the U.S. though, right?
No, it's outside the U.S.
If they don't have net neutrality laws, they're a private company. They can do what they want.
But it's so stupid.
It's capitalism.
They're just aiming their hatred at the wrong source. Like, Microsoft is... this is good.
No, I wouldn't say that. If you make a piece of software that's constantly using an internet connection...
Well, it's not so much it's constantly using an internet connection. It's the updates, which is, I think, a good thing. So much the constant, like, you know, sending data to Microsoft. Yeah, that's bad. We can agree that's bad. But the updates is what they're directing
you're
it
to. You're right. And as someone who's very security conscious, having a machine that's completely up to date is the simplest thing that you can do to prevent breaches and hacks and stuff. So I can completely get behind having always updated software, but I also think that having a choice is paramount, and so I should be able to choose whether I update my machine and not have some other company choose for me.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the problem is. So if they're choosing to use up all of my data, then that's not good. All right. Meanwhile,
sorry.
Robert smacks himself in the face.
Sorry about that.
Jesus.
But here's like one example. A lady in New Zealand. She basically service provider charge was $400 for the month of August because of Windows 10. That's super neat. And it's just flying through people's data caps. And so there is a way to disable automatic updates. It's kind of obviously not recommended by Windows 10, but it is a workaround possibility to turn off the automatic updates. But aiming hate at the wrong people, I think it's just, I don't know, it bothers me. I think we're just, this is, I think this is a step in the right direction. these like daily updates, you know, constantly fixing security updates, constantly, you know, making things better daily, not having to wait, you know, the first Tuesday of the month and whatnot.
Yeah, no, on Microsoft's part, just having a rolling, as we call it, a rolling release is absolutely the direction that you want to be going. I mean, that is the best way to keep a system secure.
Yep.
That said, choice, man. I install an OS so that I can choose what I do with it. I mean, that's remember how you once asked me, why would anyone ever choose Linux?
Oh, gosh.
I was like, I'll tell you the one reason. Because I can control every single aspect of it down to the very kernel if I want to. I have the choice when I update. I always do because I want update. I don't want security holes, but I want to be able to, just let me hit the button. Huh? Mm-hmm. I want someone in Redmond doing it. Whatever.
Mark just updated to Windows 10 recently, either today, yesterday, somewhere around there. How have you been liking it?
I like it so far. I have a couple issues with, like, you know, something with Display Fusion is a little messed up.
Okay.
With Chrome is a little messed up. Like, I have it pinned to my taskbar, and then it just won't work. It won't open, and then I'll, like, repin it, and it will work once, and then it will stop working. And I may have fixed it now. I don't know.
Not on that, but I thought that Windows 10 had a better dual monitor support.
Yeah, it does. It does, but I think I still like Display Fusion better, so I'm using it right now.
I mean, I guess. So I have Display Fusion as well, but I only use it for having different wallpapers on each monitor and having hotkeys to, like, switch windows between monitors and center them on a certain monitor, and to have be able to use your mouse on windows that aren't in focus. Those are the four things I use, and I paid $6 for it, and I'm like, all right, that's a good trade.
The mouse thing alone, I paid six bucks for. That was...
Oh, yeah. That is an excellent feature.
It doesn't seem to work as well as, like, WizMouse. It doesn't... I have Display Fusion, but I like WizMouse, too, because it works better.
You have problems with it? I've never had a problem with it.
I don't know. I was having problems. Maybe I wasn't doing it right. I have no idea. But
just showing a quick example of how it works. Basically, the mouse that I have in focus is just a bunch of files. But if I just move the mouse over to the Chrome window, it can still do it. So yeah. Phenomenal thing.
It really is very nice. So I guess just like what isn't really working with Display Fusion for you that you feel is broken?
Well, the only thing is actually what you just mentioned, the centering, the little button
centering
stuff. It centers it, but it makes it slightly larger every time. And if you do it, it makes it slightly larger every time. So, like, it really annoys me because I like to have my windows all this, like, you know, a certain size. And it just makes it just a little, like, a tiny bit. But, like, it'll keep doing it if you click it. So, I don't know why. They may have fixed that in a beta update, but I have it on Steam. So, you know, I have to wait for them to push that update to Steam, and maybe it'll work. But
yeah,
you can get Display Fusion on Steam.
Yeah, that's where I got it. I got it on sale.
I got it for $6.
I think that's how much I paid for it. So
I don't remember how much I paid for it now. Now I feel scammed. God dang it! All right. Well, anyway, moving on to the next topic. This kind of leads off of what we talked about last week. Last week it was Intel releasing unlocked Intel processors for notebooks. So basically, the discussion was that you could basically unlock a processor, and manufacturers of laptops can then basically make custom cooling solutions to overclock CPUs, which is awesome. And now we're finding out that the new NVIDIA GeForce GTX 980, which is a 990M, I mean, this article talks more about how it's based on the 980 and all that kind of stuff. But I think the really interesting thing in this... this is just updated today, so I haven't read today's update. I wonder if this is about to break everything I'm talking about. We now have new information from reliable sources that, among others, also include manufacturers with the first notebooks that use the chip. Laptops from Asus, MSI, Clevo, Lenovo, and Acer are supposed to be in the final certification process of the GPU manufacturer NVIDIA. Considering the previously mentioned GPU TDP bandwidth between 100 up to 185 watts, Only large notebook designs should be able to accommodate the mobile version of the GTX 980.
I'm sure it requires a lot of hefty cooling.
Yeah, so not overly anything different. So yeah, the thing was, basically the manufacturers here can not only now theoretically overclock the CPUs that come in their notebooks, they can now overclock, and not necessarily overclock, but basically change the amount of power that these NVIDIA cards can use, specifically this NVIDIA card can use, in order to give it more power and more oomph over, you know, gamer-oriented ones that have, you know, massive coolers and are almost as big as a desktop, and, you know, the smaller little itty-bitty computers. So you can kind of change the TDP on them, which is awesome. Like, and I think that is, and it kind of shows that in this article, considering the update about that now takes up nearly half this article. I think that was the biggest talking point about this new thing, is that it now allows manufacturers to play with the mobile 980. I guess I still don't see a need for these gaming-oriented notebooks, but why not if portability is absolutely something
you
need.
Gotta be on the go, man.
I just can't imagine. I mean, I feel like at some point it would just be much better, more efficient, and easier to build like a decent desktop and have like a decent laptop around. Because, I mean, why?
Let me tell you.
Why do you need gaming on the go?
Let me tell you.
Okay.
It's not for on the go, although it is, sort of. Imagine you're a university student, uh-huh. right? And you live in a small, tiny dorm room.
Okay.
You might not have room to prioritize your beast of a computer. So you get a laptop, take it to class, and you can play Dota while your teacher is fucking lecturing at you. Take it home. You don't have to worry about having half the room filled up with a space heater. And then you're good to go.
I mean, with a computer... Okay, let's talk about this. A computer that would have a GTX 980M in it is obviously not going to be a real portable...
It's still
going to
be large. But, I mean, I'm saying, you know, comparatively.
I think it just be much better...
All right, second use case.
Okay.
You move to Tokyo.
Okay.
And you get an apartment.
Okay.
And it's 100 square feet. You need a laptop instead of a whole computer.
I mean, my desktop doesn't take up that much space. I mean, you could put it underneath the desk. I think it's stupid.
Not everyone has two computers taking up this entire section of their room.
I don't know.
They only got one. But the two monitors take up a lot of space.
The dual monitor. Oh, yeah. I mean, our battle stations take up.
I mean, it's a quarter of my room. If you add in my, like, screw-around computer space, it takes up basically half my room.
Screw-around computer
space. I mean, here I have, like, all my extra components. Like, I have, like, three computers here. And then I got my sweet other project I've been working on this week, which is actually really good I finished this. So I'm running... My old laptop has got a second life. It's becoming shut up.
The way it's positioned, it looks like you've got, like, I don't know, like you're hacking the mainframe
right
now.
That's pretty
much or something.
What it's doing. So let me show it. This
you've
is
got
super,
like a million things
this
going
This is super
on.
Neat. So basically, the police in my area, my job is basically is media and journalism. So police in my area have switched to a digital encoded radio frequency so that these normal scanners can't pick up. It just sounds like a garbled mess of chaos. However, using an open source program called SDR Sharp and DSD Plus, basically it can take that DMR, it's DMR encoding, take that DMR digital signal, play it. I have a virtual audio cable that then runs it through this other program, which then decodes it in real time and allows playback of that decoded radio message. And so it's actually super awesome, because today my local police department switched to this DMR and I was ready. So ha! But that was my other big project this week. But so this is a good use for a laptop, I guess. I don't see like my work laptop, which I think I left at work. It got a GTX 765M and a Core i5 in there. And I mean, that's a good computer. It's in a small package, super neat, but I will never use that thing for gaming. So I mean, again, I feel like we've talked about this before in different use cases with Mark. And Mark's a good example for this because he was one that actually had the gaming PC, and then he moved on to the desktop not too long after. Was it like a year and a half or so?
Well, I got it in 2011, I believe, and then 2013 is when I built my PC, I think, or maybe, I don't know, something like that.
Okay. Well, that's super neat. So, I mean, did you find it, like, a good thing to have a gaming notebook?
I mean, I never used it, like, I never played games aside from at my desk, so I didn't, like, you know, mm-hmm. take it places to play games with.
Okay.
I used it for, you know, class and stuff. I would use it, but
all right.
I could have a normal laptop for that.
Yeah, I mean, it's also, like, for LAN parties,
it could that, make, I guess, if you have a desktop.
A little bit, yeah. That, but half I think the fun is of a LAN party is going there and having, you know, a right. sea of LEDs just wash over the room as you check out. It's like going, you know, like to the underground street race where everyone has, like, you know, the hydraulics and mm-hmm. they're underglowing. You know, you're checking them out before. And, of course, there's loud bass music and Paul Walker and half-naked women stuff. That's pretty much every LAN party
you've ever had. What LAN party are you going to? I want to get in on this, man.
Like, ooh.
Oh, man. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. I still think gaming notebooks are stupid. And I don't see a lot of any practicality in them. But they exist, and I'm sure manufacturers are making a crap ton of money off them, so.
They're just not economical.
They are expensive, yes.
They also run super hot, and they eat up like, you have to have them plugged in most of the time anyway. They suck
the
power.
I mean, if you're gaming, yes, you have to have them plugged in.
Mm-hmm. I will say, because my Alienware 14 computer actually runs pretty damn well if you're just doing, like, what my workload, which is, like, Word documents and, like, Twitter. It works pretty well. But then when you start, like, video editing and video rendering, then it gets a little bit more heated, a little bit more draining of the battery. But I could probably render out quite a few videos on one battery life.
I mean, I think I've talked about what laptop I have, you know, it's
right.
that like ultrabook. It's like a pound. I have Linux on it. I play FTL and Don't Starve, which are basically just like clip art. So, and I'm not saying they're bad games. They're awesome games, but it's like I know my limits, and that's for like when I want to do. I've got some downtime. I have my laptop. I'm like, oh, let me just, you know, clear a few star systems. Let me chop down some trees. Then I come back to my main computer. Get some real work done, by which I mean, you know, I play the shooters or the, you know, I don't even know what else I play. Yeah,
cool.
Anyway,
so next good topic I know we're gonna have a real good discussion on. So Mozilla, this headline is a little extreme, but Mozilla just built an ad blocker into Firefox. Not exactly. But it's basically their new developer version of Firefox. They have a new technology in it that's improving security. And by doing so, they have essentially blocked advertising. It doesn't allow advertisers to, you know, reach your computer. Doesn't allow Google Ads to target you, essentially. And so it's... I think it's more so inadvertently making an ad blocker into this new version of Firefox. This is something that might change with a final release as opposed to just a developer version. But I think it's a terrible, terrible thing. I am not saying I survive on advertising revenue through the internet, but it definitely pays for most of the garbage you see me building in my YouTube channel. It's just that little extra, you know, money through advertising, either through my Midwest Weather Center website or either through my YouTube videos. And the more and more people that use Adblock, it's significantly hurting the free internet as it is. I think it's a terrible thing. And if you have an ad blocker installed, which I do for websites that I don't frequent, because a lot of websites pop up with these full screen things that are like, sign up for our newsletter, and those just need to die. That's why Adblock exists, because those are super annoying and those people can go fuck themselves. But for like the little ads that are on like the side of things, like in articles, I think that's perfectly fine. Even like YouTube video ads, I can deal with a 30-second ad to watch my favorite YouTuber. And I whitelist a lot of my YouTubers that I normally watch just so they can get that YouTube money. Tom, rebuttal.
Let me tell you why you're wrong here, Nick. All right. There's a couple points to my rebuttal.
Okay.
First of all, I picked up on a phrase you used.
Uh-oh.
You said this new technology prevents Google from tracking you to serve you ads. You're right. Now, let me tell you why that's not a problem. Now, I'm not talking specifically about this. All right, this specific technology, the way this article's worded, it seems like it completely blocks ads.
Mm-hmm.
But from the screenshot, it looks like it just blocks tracking.
That's kind of what I'm assuming, yeah.
Those are two different things.
Exactly.
So for those who don't know, ad networks these days have a whole multitude of ways of basically profiling every specific internet user, profiling specific people, including you, and unless you compulsively clear your cookies and turn off JavaScript, you're basically being tracked. And even there are ways around that too. So this, you know, it may sound a little tinfoil hat, but like the whole point is that these ad companies, if they can track you on what pages you're looking at on the internet, they can serve you more tailored ads. So, you know, if you Google whatever, you know, the latest model Nissan or something, and then you go to a different website, you'll probably start seeing ads for that car.
Mm-hmm.
Stuff like that. Now, that's tracking. And now they tried to introduce this thing called Do Not Track, where basically it just tells websites, yeah, I don't want to be tracked, but it's not compulsory and they can completely ignore that. So when you say it prevents people from seeing ads, that I agree. We can't just have a free internet. I mean, someone has to pay the bill for running a website. And I understand that most websites do that by placing ads. The problem is when it becomes invasive to the point of, you know, I can't look at anything without being followed by something, that's when it becomes a problem.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's just like means I won't see a personalized ad before a YouTube video, but I'll still see an ad, then I don't think that's an issue necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
I'm okay with it blocking the tracking. Blocking ads outright does create a problem, and I'm on your side there, because like I said, you know, it's not just free to run a website, and I recognize that, and unless you want to start moving to a subscription model for websites, you basically have to deal with ads. That's how the internet works.
I mean, you're seeing people already having to respond to the decline in revenue. For example, the website Vessel, I don't know if you've heard of it. Vessel basically is a new website that YouTubers will upload videos to first, give them like a 7-day exclusive on Vessel before they upload them to YouTube. And Vessel is a subscription service, kind of like Netflix. I think it's like $3 a month you have to pay to. And the YouTubers then get basically a pay-per-view on how many views they get. And so like one of my favorite YouTubers that I watch very regularly, Linus Tech Tips, or Linus Sebastian with, you know, Linus Media Group, they switched to Vessel. They've kind of been like the flagship Vessel company for, I want to say, like 6 months or so. And so, I mean, I got Vessel because I want to see their videos first. I'm kind of that interested in it. Plus, I like supporting them in some way. I mean, I use their Amazon affiliate code and whatever whenever I shop on Amazon, because, you know, whatever, I buy stuff all the time anyway. Might as well give them money that I don't have to spend, so whatever. But I think that the free internet is slowly dying because of Adblock, and I think Vessel is a very good example of how it's starting to go away. So do you guys use Adblock? I'm assuming probably you do.
Yeah.
Mark,
do you? Yeah. Yeah, I do.
Do you like whitelist any pages?
Yes.
You do.
I whitelist the pages that I use regularly, because I recognize, you know, things, but it's nice when it's unobtrusive. I mean, so I use DuckDuckGo because I'm a privacy freak, but like, they'll say, and a lot of websites do this nowadays, they'll be like, we notice you're using Adblock. If you could whitelist us, it does help us out a lot. Mm-hmm. So now when I search something, it does insert a little thing that's like an ad that's clearly marked as an ad, and it's just plain text. So you know what's an ad, you know what's not. I'm like, all right, I can deal with this. Mm-hmm. And it's for a website that I want to support. So,
yeah, because like the website we're looking at right now, geek.com, I think this is a good use of ads. There's, you know, a banner ad up at the top, small ad over here, low ad down here. And funny, because I was looking at switching to Verizon, and look, there's all these Verizon
there
ads.
There it is, man.
Right
there. They're getting you. See, this is what I'm talking about. And also, all right, and here's the other problem I have with ads in general. You have to understand where these ads come from. A lot of the time, they're ad networks that operate separately from the website, and it's just a matter of people buy ads through the network, and then if that network has a deal with a website, they just get served to all those websites. That's fine. That's a good division of labor. That's how, you know, it makes sense. No one website could handle this whole thing by itself. However, I think it was just last week or maybe 2 weeks ago, there were malicious ads being served off of an ad network. Basically, people were putting in malware and exploitative JavaScript that could run execute this vulnerability and somehow compromise your machine. And they were running it through a network that was then advertising on Yahoo. Now, Yahoo is a pretty big name. I go there for multiple email accounts, like, but I have Adblock on, and so I don't see these things. And so it's kind of like, if you want me to trust you enough to disable Adblock and to actually see your ads, I feel like there should be a give and take here. They should kind of vet where they're getting this content, because I don't want to have to deal with, you know, I don't want to open myself up to yet another attack vector.
Yeah.
So, and also, here's the thing. Even if I disabled Adblock, I still have NoScript and Disconnect Me on, and those already block things specifically for ads, so I probably wouldn't see it in all reality. But that's just because I like to live in my walled fortress here.
It's not a bad thing. So Mark, do you whitelist anybody, or do you any of that?
I haven't really I have thought about it, but I don't, but I should. I probably will now that you're talking about it. So
do you feel bad that you're ripping? Changed. Do you feel bad you're ripping money out of your favorite creators, man?
Well, no.
Nah, not really. Okay,
fair enough. Like I said,
I probably will. I'll whitelist some shit. Okay. I'll do it.
Like I said, I feel bad for websites I use all the time, which is why I whitelist them. But just random news sites I'll go to that are always like, download our app as soon as you log on the website, I immediately nope out of that website. I'm just done. Like, that's why Adblock exists, is because of stupid ads that just take up your full page, don't allow you to do anything for like 15 seconds.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm just angry now. It's gotta.
Well, as a little, this is kind of a while ago, I know there was an initiative at Google to basically leverage their ad network to provide subscription services. So basically, a website could go there, and instead of getting AdSense, they could get a subscription model.
I see.
And they could tell their users, like, if you want to subscribe, basically they wouldn't have to build in a whole user system for, you know, like, so you'd have to log into every web. And that's the other problem. Like, even if every website had a, you know, subscription model, then you would have to create an account on every website, log in every time you go there, or just, you know, stay logged in more likely. But, you know, you have to then basically manage 10 more accounts. But the whole point with Google was if you just log in with Google and then every website you go to has this subscription mm-hmm. model, it would just all, piggyback off of that and you wouldn't see ads. Which, I mean, if you can implement something like that that works across basically any website, you know, I think that makes a little bit more sense and could be the way that the internet's going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because like I said, here's like Vessel as the example, which is like the subscription-based thing. All their videos you'll see on here first, except for certain videos that are like probably like really hot topics or something, or like brand new, you know, content they'll probably release on all platforms right away, especially if they're like sponsored videos or whatever. So I haven't even seen this yet, so I'm really excited to watch this video, this robbery prank. I've been hearing things about it. So, okay, so the free internet, it's in jeopardy, and only you can prevent that by whitelisting your favorite people. So moving on to this thing, which I'm not sure how I feel about it either. You know, you've had, when the Xbox One released, there was all sorts of annoying and complaints and things about the always-on NIS of the Xbox One, and then of course the what's that thing, Kinect, Xbox Kinect, that's just always listening and always that creepy thing. Well, with new Intel processors, basically you can wake your computer with your voice. So in the morning you could say, you know, like, bro, wake up, and just make it wake up. Which is kind of the epitome of lazy, considering hit a button, come on guys. But kind of cool, I guess, if you're into that sort of thing. I personally don't like the always listening concept, but if you're into that, here you go. Skylake is your in. Taking advantage of things like Microsoft Cortana, I'm sure that's something that could definitely be done with Windows 10. And yeah, would any of you take advantage of this?
Hell no.
Hell no.
No.
I mean, I'm going to reserve myself until the next article we get to. Although I will say probably not, but that's mostly just a not going to Windows 10 thing than a not wanting. I also kind of see voice controls as a gimmick.
I do too.
I mean, phones have had them for at least a good couple of years, and I've never used it. I've never used it to search. I've never used it to add a new contact or put an appointment in. It's just, I don't know. I think it's mostly because when I like go to like the grocery store, you know, I'm just walking around town and I see those people just yelling into their phone like 6 inches from their face. I'm like, either you look like an idiot or you're just, I'm mad at you already because you inconvenience me with having to hear you set up your life. I don't want to hear that. Just, yeah, God. To the point where if they've got the clicks still on while they're fucking typing, I'm just like, I just want to smack it out of their hand and just kick it out of the subway and watch it leave.
All about that whatever. Haptic feedback.
All about the haptic. Well, that also drains the shit out of your battery.
Well, yeah,
so.
But...
yeah, but you like the way it buzzes? That's fine. That's just, fine. That I can handle. I don't hear it, so I don't give a shit.
I know one person that uses, like, Siri all the time.
Yeah.
One person. I also don't know many people that have Apple phones, thankfully.
Yeah.
But that means I'm with a smart group of people, usually. But the one person I know that has, like, an Apple phone always uses Siri for everything. For navigation, for, like, just everything. At one point, I hijacked her phone while she was away. And now anytime, like, when you say, like, hey, Siri, and like, you know, it says a person's name, it says, like, go buy an Android. It's basically what it says is, like, something, 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 go buy an Android is now the person's name. So whenever the person, like, says something, comes back as that. So I laugh every time I hear it. She like says it, it's like
good stuff.
She hasn't changed it back. I don't know why.
Yeah.
But yeah,
go ahead. Well, I was just gonna say that is the one place where I would be like, okay, this is a valuable technology, is driving.
Yeah, I do use it yes. for texting quite often.
So something like that, if you're in the car, hands free, you want to send a text, you don't want to call someone, or you're like, oh, I need to go here, but I don't want to pull my GPS down, find it while I'm driving. I need to change route or something.
Mm-hmm.
all right, valid use, but that's such a niche use case.
Yeah.
I just have no need for it, especially not on my desktop. It's like I have a keyboard and a mouse. They both work perfectly fine for what they do. That's mm-hmm. it.
But. Like I said, driving, I think like I said, is probably the only application I can really think it was. I'm seeing like some things like the voice control for like the new Pebble Time Watch, and then other products as well, being able to, you know, integrate voice with that. And I've seen some pretty good, you know, applications of it. I still just don't know how much it's an everyday person is going to be using it as opposed to like a tech review.
Yeah.
But
also the watches, whenever I see the watches, like I think it's the Samsung Galaxy Gear where you can make phone calls on your watch. Mm-hmm. That just reminds me of Dick Tracy where they just got the watch walkie talkies and they're just like, all right, we got to have a hunch. It's mm-hmm. like, same thing with the guy talking into his phone. I don't want to talk to my wrist either. Like it's goofy.
Yeah, I agree.
To me.
For most people, whatever. I think I can agree.
Whatever.
But again, this technology that allows you to wake up with your voice basically comes very much off the new technology. So basically when Skylake came out, we didn't really know a lot about it. We didn't know a lot of the dirty details about Skylake. One thing that came out recently, though, at their most recent conference earlier this week, or was it late last week? I think it was this week, right? Wasn't it like Monday, Tuesday?
Yeah.
Sure. They started, one of the big things is talking about the... basically the power efficiency on these computers and being able to explain it a little bit better. I'm trying to fudging for words right now, and you're the one that was talking about this earlier, so.
For just power usage?
Yeah, the P time,
you mean
whatever.
Just in general, or this specific
the
paragraph?
The specific thing that you're talking about.
So basically...
P state, that's what I was trying to think of.
Yeah. Basically, whenever you upgrade a processor, typically you make the various components of it smaller, and the smaller components don't need to use up as much power to do the same thing as the bigger components. So every generation of processor, for the most part, gets more power efficient. That also means that we can do more with less power. So basically, what Intel has been pushing for a lot in a lot of recent revisions is to just have ultra low power states that just run very specific parts of the chip that are really just looking for wake up calls. So you can have, even on current, on my Haswell, I'm pretty sure it even extended back to the Sandy Bridge. They had low power Ivy Bridge revision, but some of the more recent ones. They had low power states where basically it was just above absolute zero, and it would just, you could turn your, but it was still running, so you could just like press a key or press your mouse and it would be on in a couple of seconds. With Skylake, they've added a signal processing hardware section. So they have image processing and audio signal processing, and they have these low power states that I can just quote here from the article. Basically, a new technology dubbed Intel Speed Shift also allows Skylake to switch P states, just power states, much faster than previous gen. They can control P states fully in hardware, whereas previous gen had to use OS control. So all that means is they can, just without requiring like Windows, for example, to intervene, they can just switch from effectively off to the on state. Now, like I said, though, they have the signal processing cores, so that's how you get these things like the last article with the Hey Cortana stuff. Basically, they can be listening for an audio cue, process that signal, and then switch power states to on. So I don't think it's necessarily... That's why I was saying I'll hold off on comment. I don't think it's necessarily creepy. The way that article is written made it sound like these new CPUs are like built to basically be spying on you.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the hardware is there to basically be listening while the computer's off, but it's not necessarily built specifically for that purpose. I think it's built so that basically you can say something and then that signal will be processed and then just shift the hardware into a different power state, mm-hmm. not necessarily... you know, capture whatever you're saying, wrap it up in a packet, and then send it out across the Ethernet on your motherboard, which kind of gets into the whole, then you have a North bridge on your motherboard, we're just talking. So basically, they're different components. I don't think it's necessarily that creepy. Of course, wait for the next DEF CON, wait for the next Black Hat. I'm sure
someone's going to take advantage of it.
Yeah, there's always going to be an exploit, but... You know, I mean, like last we were talking about, there's been an exploit in Intel processors since the 90s. I mean, there's always another exploit to take advantage of. I just don't see it as like a, you know, they put this in here just so we could spy on you. I think it's just, here's the hardware that can do this one thing.
I mean, obviously, that's what you get for reading a Verge article, of course, with the scandalous headlines as my news source. But
that clickbait, man.
Yeah, it's killing journalism, too. So, I feel like I'm the last media organization that will like refuses to use clickbait headlines. Anytime like someone I work with like suggested, I just slap them like, no, we respect our craft. We don't do this shit.
Journalistic integrity, man.
I try. As soon as I'm gone, though, who the hell knows what's gonna happen?
Down the drain.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, it's cool technology. It's definitely interesting. It has many a use.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing. Yeah. You keep in mind, this isn't like isolated. It's not just for turning your computer on. It's a signal processor built into the hardware, which means that any signal processing should theoretically be better. So, you know, you can have better voice recognition just when your computer is already on, or you can just, you know, have better audio in general, better image. It's also an image processor. Mm-hmm. It should be a lot more powerful in a couple of different ways, but, you know, like I said, or I think like we've mentioned, basically, at a certain point, you can only add so many new features or revise, you know, the way you can't change how you add two numbers together. So yeah. We've already kind of perfected the adding unit. Now we just need to start adding new stuff. It's like, what do we have? A signal processor. Throw that on there. You know, what are you gonna do?
The other big thing I know coming out with a lot of like the newer things is like the high bandwidth memory, and that's something that's been really, really big coming soon. So finding ways to remove bottlenecks, that's another thing that you'll probably be hearing a lot more about in the coming probably year or two. High bandwidth memory, I think, will be becoming more of a discussion topic for hardware manufacturers and all that. Speaking of memory, kind of. And also Intel. I'm not the best at segues. So the new hard drives also announced at this wonderful conference by Intel. They're called the Optane drives. Apparently can operate as much as 1,000 times faster as flash memory inside hard drives, memory sticks, and mobile devices today. Those are big talking words, and it's obviously going to come with a big price tag. Maybe, usually. First edition, anyway, will probably come with a big price tag.
Yeah, so I don't remember. Did we talk about this new memory tech?
I don't think so. I don't think we have.
2 weeks ago,
I'm pretty sure we had not.
All right, so basically Intel and Micron have developed this new point. They're this new type of memory called 3D cross-point memory. It's just a different iteration, different type of storage technology, and... It's supposedly 1,000 times faster than flash. It's 1,000 times more durable than flash. And it comes in between DRAM prices and NAND flash prices. So expect to see these drives to cost somewhere between normal SSDs now and imagine if you were buying, you know, 128 gigabytes of RAM for your computer, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not going to be prohibitively expensive, but it's definitely not going to be like an upgrade we're probably going to make in the next couple of years. They also did mention in practice, the speeds on these drives that they're introducing in 2016 were about 7 times faster than current top-end drives, which is still not, you know, it's still a significant and noteworthy bump up in speed. You know, it's nothing to shrug off, and it's only going to get faster as they work out the kinks and basically make it more economic. I mean, it's like any even solid states. Look at solid states, where they were 5 years ago. They were really expensive, really high end stuff. Now everyone, pretty much all, we all have solid states now.
I think
we all
have solid states now. So, Kevin, does he? I think he does.
I think he does, but he doesn't even have Windows installed on it.
So he's just using it like a storage?
So he just
I don't know what he uses it for. If he even, I don't even know if he uses it.
It's okay. Just like in his computer, he's not even using
it. Like he said he hasn't gotten around to it. I don't know if he's ever going to get around to it. That's like the main thing you do.
I mean, like, the if there's one upgrade for a person that's, like, building their first computer that they're looking to spend a little extra money on, solid-state drive is, like, the biggest thing I always tell people. Like, get a solid-state drive. I guarantee it, you'll be satisfied. I mean, boot times alone for turning on your computer, loading programs, like, boom. It's fantastic. Right.
It's like $100. It's like...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, I squeezed by with a 64 gig for, it was probably only a year. But the point is, you could probably get away with it. So I just had Windows installed on it and then just, like, my core programs. And, you know, even if you don't install games to it to load things up really fast, the fact that I could just hit the go from hitting the power button to then just on my taskbar hitting Windows 2 and having a browser window open in under a minute was, you know, I mean, that alone was worth the investment. So,
I mean,
Oh, you have a 64.
Yeah, I'm still rocking the same ones that we both bought, the OCZ Agility 3, I think is what it was called. I'm still rocking it. I've got, you know, 5 gigs free that I barely scrape by with here and there.
Yeah.
Deleting things here and there. I have a Kingston one that I haven't...
You bought that like 5 months ago.
I've been using it... I use it for like...
Put it in already.
For like... other builds I make for like benchmarking computers, I just use that drive instead. I don't know.
All right. Well, if you're using it for benchmarks, that eliminates the bottleneck on the hard drive side, I guess.
Mm-hmm. So that's why I try and do it for anyway. But like I said, if you're looking for a way to upgrade your computer, by far a solid state drive is the way to go. And with it's still today, I think it is solid state drives, which not solid state drives, but hard drives and solid state drives are still, I think, our biggest bottleneck in hardware today. I mean, you see the graphics cards are getting pretty freaking phenomenal. Yeah. Your CPUs are getting pretty freaking phenomenal. And then now we're moving up to DDR4. I mean, which early on DDR3, DDR4 isn't, you know, that much of a difference. But the thing with DDR4 is people are finding ways to make these run incredibly much faster. I mean, you have these new kits being announced at this Intel conference again, which is really kind of a constant theme today. You have, like, G-Skill. I believe they have DDR4 kits coming out soon that are pushing 4,400 megahertz, just consumer-grade DDR4. So the biggest thing with DDR4 is definitely pushing those speeds up. And once you start, at this point in time, Skylake is pushing that technology. So you have awesome RAM, awesome CPU, your GTX 980 in there, boom. I think at the point, still, the hard drive is now becoming the bottleneck for programs, which isn't, a significant bottleneck. I mean, there's not a lot of things where it's really going to be hampering you, but if you get like a 10 gig NIC card in there and just you start using that instead, connect to some crazy server for all your data, and boom.
Honestly, that is the big bottleneck is the internet right now. Mm-hmm. In terms of data transfer, I mean, there's that old adage, never underestimate the bandwidth of a station wagon full of hard drives shuttling down the expressway.
It's very true.
Yeah, so that's but in terms of just your own local computer, your storage media is probably your bottleneck, and also the lanes on your motherboard. Because, we can make as fast as we want graphics cards, but if we can't shuttle all of that data to the CPU for display, it doesn't really, for control, it doesn't really do anything for us. But that's the things, like with Skylake, they have widened out the lanes, the fact that they can support DDR4, the fact that they can support PCIe 3 is all. That was a couple generations ago, but yeah, basically.
When I was living in the dorms of my university, the easiest way to send files back and forth was just to send flash drives because our internet was so terrible.
Yeah.
So there were many times when I would just send work files back and forth just on, like, portable hard drives and flash drives instead of, like, any other method. So much faster. I mean, at least now, with Comcast, as much as I hate it, their internet speeds are pretty good for me anyway in terms of that respect. So I've running less into that much of a roadblock.
No, I mean for most stuff it's good. I mean, it's just going forward, things like streaming 4K video. That's going to require a lot of bandwidth and stuff. But I mean, you know, for like gaming and shit, I mean, for internet browsing, that takes a couple of kilobytes. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're not. So,
Very interesting video came out from Linus Media Group too. I keep bringing them out. Another common theme today. They did a video comparison basically on 1080p versus 4K, and basically if YouTube creators should be creating videos in 1080p or 4K. And I guess before I say anything, I ask you guys, what do you normally would watch videos at on your computer? Do you watch it to your normal, like your monitor's resolution, or do you watch it something lower or something higher? So Mark, what's your YouTube viewing experience like?
Well, the default's what, 720?
Mm-hmm.
I pretty much just watch it at that, unless it's something that I'm going to watch in full screen, I guess I would switch it to 1080, but I rarely even do that, so.
If it had a 4K option, would you even consider switching to 4K?
Just probably not.
Okay, how about Tom?
Yeah, I'm going to be honest. I don't think I've ever full-screened a video, ever. that's not true, obviously. But, like, I really don't bother with it. The only thing I would ever consider full-screening would be, like, a trailer for something.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, watch this funny video, I just leave it at... I don't even make it the larger player. I just watch it at, like, 480 and just, you know... Because I'm there for the content. If it's something I need to see... Like, if I'm watching an instructional video that I need to, like, actually see stuff going on, I'll pull it up in 720 and do the larger player. But I pretty much never go higher than 720 just because I don't really feel the need to, I guess.
Okay. Well, in this testing that they did, it's actually very interesting. If you film in 1080p, you export a video in 4K, then upload it to YouTube... The quality is significantly better on the 4K version because YouTube will automatically allot a higher bitrate for 4K videos. And so you're getting a better quality 1080p video when you watch 4K. I thought that was super amazing and super awesome. And so, yeah. There you go. I don't know how we got on this topic, but upload your videos in 4K. Because basically, it all came down to... the discussion was, should you buy like a 4K camera or should you get like a high-end 1080p camera? And they basically concluded that getting a high-end 1080p camera would be better. If you export to 4K, the quality is still like really good. So,
yeah.
Fun things. Also touching on storage, you got the Samsung V-NAND high-performance solid-state drives, the NVMe standard, which is coming more and more out there. They're the newest to jump on the bandwagon. Transferring rates at 5.5 gigabit per second. So, woo!
So
pretty freaking cool. Again, the PCI slots that we were talking about earlier.
A couple things to point out. That slot, like we were saying, the bandwidth is kind of the big bottleneck there. So, just going over SATA nowadays, it isn't even as fast as going over something more, or not proprietary, but something different like M2 or this NVMe.
Mm-hmm.
Also, VNAND, I mean, that's just sort of, the reason I posted this article was basically it's just a good example of how the future of solid state technology. And just that it's getting faster and that this VNAND stuff is actually viable and market ready.
The cool things about this too is not only is it obviously insanely fast, but the storage capacity is actually pretty freaking awesome too.
Yeah.
The versions they have are 3.2 terabyte and 6.4 terabyte, which is awesome. So cool.
It's quite a bit.
And the drives are each rated to handle... 5 drive writes per day, or 32 terabytes for
32
5 years,
yeah.
Which is super freaking cool.
32 terabytes a day for 5 years.
Which is like, mind blown.
You're pretty much good.
And then to give that kind of an example, a hypothetical example for how fast you can transfer here, I can save a 5 gigabyte video file in less than 3 seconds.
Yeah.
So the future is pretty neat. oh man, I know the I believe it's the NVMe standard. It's coming more and more, especially with Skylake. I'm pretty sure that's the standard with Skylake, I believe. Maybe?
I don't know about standard, but it definitely supports it. And okay. You need support for it to actually become a standard. So,
right.
Like everything that we've talked about today, basically, you got to wait for the devs to actually start building stuff with it. Mm-hmm. And it'll all come down from there.
That's probably these developer conferences and big exhibitions are super awesome because everyone just has like these crazy concept devices that utilize everything, and then a year down the line, it's like, oh, it's not what I thought it was.
It's got to give it time.
I want to get one of these so bad though, just because I go through so much video and pictures every day. If like the amount of money. Time is money, The amount of money I would save just by getting something that can transfer that fast would just make my life a better thing. It'd be great. So if I just switch to, FireWire? That's not it.
FireWire is the old Thunderbolt. One. Thunderbolt. That's something new one, yeah.
Thunderbolt. Switch to Thunderbolt and have some of these drives will be good shape. I'm glad Windows things are starting to use Thunderbolt more. It's starting to become more on a lot of the higher-end devices.
More standard,
about
yeah.
About freaking time.
I'm holding out for that USB 3, man.
Well, that 3. USB Type-C, too.
Type-C, yeah.
Yeah, that looks really, really good, too. So, the future is here for memory.
Future's close.
Yeah, I wouldn't say near.
It's not.
It's getting near. Well, I think that's pretty much, we covered a lot of, I think it was a really good, I came into today thinking we didn't really have that many topics, and I think this is actually one of the better shows, because there's, I think.
Wow.
Because, I mean, probably because.
I'm not saying that everyone else that we've had on so far.
They
sucks.
Just ruined it. I'm sorry, they're not going to watch this anyway, but so let's just call them out right now.
There's just Ryan streaming right now, and like, those motherfuckers.
No, but DirectX 12, I think, is a very interesting topic, and talking about the future of, gaming notebooks and all that, really cool, and our discussion on Adblock. I think that was the big three topics. So.
It's worthwhile, man.
All right. Any closing thoughts as we close out the 8th episode of the Bobcast Podcast?
No.
Mark?
I think, actually, yes. Oh, okay. Sorry. But I'll let Mark go first.
Mark, anything? Got anything?
I got nothing.
Got nothing? All right, Tom, go ahead.
All right. Next week, we also have to be upbeat. Because the first two were kind of downers. We were talking about hacks and how unsafe the world is. This one was upbeat. It's like, hey, the future is actually a pretty great place. So next week, we also have to do something that's like uplifting. And then the week after that, we'll do like, and
then
this
we'll
is why the
really
world sucks.
Go downhill, yeah, like real. This,
yeah. And we'll just alternate, and that'll be the pattern.
Okay. I like it.
There you go.
All right. Well, thanks for tuning in, guys. We'll be back aroundish the same time next week live on twitch.tv. It'll be our new streaming platform from now on. So thank you for watching, and we'll see you again next time.